We will start the lecture named myocarditis. Myocarditis means the presence of inflammatory cells inside the myocardium, and by its broadest sense, myocarditis refers to any injury to the myocardium, which may be due to external antigens like viruses, bacteria, or others, or due to internal triggers due to autoimmune reaction against self-antigen. The final common pathway of any injury to the myocardium is the presence of inflammatory cell inside the myocardium, leading to a clinical presentation of either heart failure, angina-like symptoms, arrhythmia, myopericarditis, and pericardial effusion. If we can establish a causal relationship between the presence of the inflammatory cells inside the myocardium and the clinical presentation, then the diagnosis of myocarditis is established as definite cause. The myocarditis have been defined by the WHO as the presence of inflammatory cell inside the myocardium and named it as inflammatory cardiomyopathy. The criteria defining myocarditis as the presence of degeneration, necrosis, or both. However, the on one condition is not typical of ischemic myocardial damage. 10 years later, the European Society of Cardiology, using immunohistochemical staining to define cell antigen, has defined the definition of myocarditis as the presence of at least 14 lymphocytes with at least 7 cells T lymphocytes with no more than 4 cells macrophage. This leads to improve the sensitivity of the diagnosis of myocarditis by histopathology. The precise epidemiologic estimate is very difficult because the endomyocardial biopsy is frequently performed outside of referral center. There are different histologic criteria as we see to define myocarditis, the old Dallas criteria, the recently used technique by immunohistochemical staining, detection of viral genome, leading to heterogeneity in the incidence and the prevalence of myocarditis. And finally, most of the patients are asymptomatic. The disease is usually or largely underdiagnosed. In addition, the clinical heterogeneity of the manifestation, ranging from asymptomatic in most patients to life-threatening condition with rapidly progressive heart failure, high-grade AV block, and ventricular arrhythmia leading to death. The burden of myocarditis as a percentage of prevailing heart failure varies from 0.5% to 4% according to age and region. It should be noted that myocarditis is the third leading cause of sudden cardiac death after hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and coronary artery disease. The incidence shows slight male predominance, which may be mediated by sex hormones. The prevalence of myocarditis two modes or bimodal. First surge during the first year of life and the second surge about the age of 40, from puberty to the age of 40. The median age of lymphocytic myocarditis is stated to be 42 years old. From this slide, we can recognize that the myocarditis is a heterogeneous disease. Very long list of etiologies ranging from and maybe infectious causes, non-infectious causes, or autoimmune. But by far, viral myocarditis is the most common identified cause of myocarditis. We will discuss extensively. We will start by parvovirus P19, which received considerable attention during the last couple of decades. This virus is spread by respiratory route. It is a non-enveloped single-stranded DNA virus. It binds to group B antigen found on the erythroid progenitors, erythroblast or megakaryocyte, and the endothelial cell. So it is called an erythrotropic and endotheliotropic virus. This virus has been prevalent. The prevalence of the infection by this virus is quite high in the general population. It stated that up to 80% of the elderly group show positive antibodies against parvovirus B19. This leads to a question if this virus is essentially has a pathogenic role or not. This question is answered by the two. The prevalence of or the activity of the virus, which can be measured either by detecting the number of the virus, which is called the CAPI number, or the presence of viral replicative intermediate. Both relate to activity of the virus or answer the question of its pathogenic role. Another astonishing piece of information is the virus is endotheliotropic. It infects the endothelium. How can it cause myocarditis? It may be a bystander role. enterovirus, including Coxsackie virus. This virus was the most common etiology of viral myocarditis in the 80s and in the 60s. Coxsackie virus is a member of enterovirus that joined the Bicronoviridae family. It is an unenveloped virus, single positive stranded RNA. Recently, there is a decrease in the prevalence of enterovirus, particularly in the Western Europe. This may be due to development of herd immunity or confounding by seasonal outbreak. Coxsackie virus meets the criteria of Koch postulate as a cause of myocarditis. What's the Koch postulate? Koch postulates mean that the Coxsackie virus can be found in every disease. Then the virus can be isolated in a pure culture. Then the virus, when injected or inoculated into an animal model, most probably mice, it recapitulates the disease. And finally, it can be recovered from the infected mouse. Coxsackie virus is one of the most heavily studied virus in the etiology of myocarditis. It meets all the four criteria. It enters the body through the gastrointestinal or respiratory routes. It binds the cell through a receptor called a CAR receptor, which is Coxsackie virus adenovirus receptor. There it evokes immune response. It may lead to a broad clinical symptoms, including meningitis, in rash, respiratory illness, or skeletal muscle myocarditis. Bacterial infection. Virtually any bacterial agent can cause myocardial dysfunction. At the part of sepsis, it depresses the myocardium. However, there is a special features. In case of Corynebacterium diphtheriae, which is largely decreased in the recent year because of the mass vaccination. However, the Corynebacterium can affect the heart through the exotoxin, leading to the damage both of the myocardium and its conductive system. Streptococcal infection, upper respiratory tract infection, which evoke an autoimmune reaction leading to the development of rheumatic heart disease, which is endemic in Egypt. Lyme carditis mediated by the tick-borne spirochetes lead to characteristic rash, erythema chronica migraine, followed by acute neurologic joint or cardiac involvement. Regarding its cardiovascular manifestation, it leads to transient atrioventricular block of various degrees. Protozoa, Chagas disease. Chagas disease is the most common of non-ischemic cardiomyopathy worldwide. It has been described by Carlos Chagas in the 19th century, and it describes the complex life cycle of this flagellum protozoan named Trypanosoma cruzi. Trypanosoma cruzi can be found in the armadillo and the domestic cat. Then the bug feed on the blood of these animals. Then it develop in its gut, leading to development of metamastiubate. When this bug infects the human through the skin or the mucous membrane, the epimastiubate get through the skin or the mucous membrane, passes through the blood, it passes through the muscles or neurologic tissue, which form a large nest that destroy this tissue, leading to myocarditis or affection of neurologic tissue or gastrointestinal tract. The clinical presentation of Chagas disease is very characteristic and strange. The symptoms typically begin 1 to 2 weeks after a bite from infected triatomin, which is the bug, or few months following the blood transfusion. The acute phase lasts for 1 to 2 months. Most of the patient is asymptomatic. If the patient develops cardiovascular manifestation, it usually non-specific ECG changes, first degree of a block, or cardiomegaly on chest X-ray. The most common ECG abnormality is right bundle branch block. Treatment during this phase leads to cure of the patient. 90% of these patients, the symptom resolve spontaneously, and only 30 to 40% develop typical clinical manifestation of the chronic form, which manifests within 5 to 15 years after the initial infection, very long time. It affects two major systems, the heart and the gastrointestinal tract. In the heart, extensive fibrosis leading to destruction of the heart, development of heart failure, thinning of the myocardium, aneurysm formation with thrombus inside and thromboembolic phenomena. In the gastrointestinal tract, it destroys the mesenteric or myopath plexus, leading to megacolon and megaesophagus. 50 to 90% with chronic Chagas disease remain asymptomatic despite ongoing pathologic process. The treatment of Chagas disease is indicated in nearly all patients to eradicate the parasite in the young and the old, with a special attention to patients considered for organ transplantation or who develop HIV virus. The only contraindication is patients with advanced heart failure. This slide summarizes the immune response when the virus enters the body. When the virus enters the body, it binds to its receptor, it enters inside the cell, then the immune response is evoked. There are two major immune systems, the innate immunity and the acquired immunity. The innate immunity is early, quick, however, it is called antigen non-specific. It consists mainly of the natural killer cell and dendritic cell. They attack the virus, bind the virus, and destroy the virus through secretions of interferons, many types of interferons. Then later on, the acquired immunity takes over. The antigen presented to the T cell in conjunction with histocompatibility complex on the surface of the dendritic cell. Then the T lymphocytes, when it recognizes it, it activates the B lymphocyte secreting antibodies, and it recruits its subtypes, T helper cells. There are two types of the T cells, the T helper cell which evoke inflammation and regulatory cells which suppress inflammation. At the end, after all this pathologic and immune process, it will end either by the regulatory element take over and restore the balance and the immune reaction suppressed, leading to mild form of the disease, mild cardiac dysfunction with possible myocyte hypertrophy or mild scarring, and the patient survives with virus clearing and downregulation of the immune system. On the other hand, if the effector immune cells, the T helper 1, T helper 17, cytokine secretions take over and it lingers on, it leads to progression to cardiomyopathy with myocardial damage, left ventricular dilatation, depression of ejection fraction, and development of cardiomyopathy. What's the role of microRNA? In 2016, a paper released describing the role of microRNA, which is an epigenetic regulator of cardiac immune response. This is a small RNA molecule, which is an endogenous inside the body and non-coding, post-transcriptionally regulates the gene expression. Some of them inhibit viral replication and inhibit inflammation, and some of them evokes inflammation. As we see, the orchestration between activation and suppression of inflammation lead to modulation of the course of myocarditis. These epigenetics, these small RNA molecule, microRNAs, are under investigation as a tool for diagnosis of myocarditis or predicting the prognosis. Not only this, it also is as a target for treatment of myocarditis in the future. The presentation of myocarditis, as we said, is very heterogeneous, ranging from asymptomatic. Most of the patients are asymptomatic, chest pain, heart failure, arrhythmia, heart block, ventricular tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, or take a heroic course of cardiogenic shock, hemodynamic collapse, necessity of mechanical circulatory assist device, or even cardiac transplantation. There are two surges of myocarditis, very at the young age and a middle age. According to the maturity of the immune system, the clinical presentation may be determined. In the young children and the teenagers, this is usually the first exposure to the virus, leading to vigorous immune response, a release of a large amount of cytokine, tissue destruction, and fulminant presentation. In the older adult, this is usually previous experience with the virus, leading to, as we said, tolerance of the immune system, leading to milder form of the disease and the development of heart failure. According to the type of the virus, as we said, parvovirus virus C19, it is an erythrotropic and endotheliotropic virus, usually affects the endothelium lining the heart and also the endothelium of the coronary arteries, leading to vasospasm and the myocardial infarction-like picture. On the other hand, giant cell myocarditis as the etiology, leading to rapidly progressive heart failure, not responding to the usual treatment, ventricular arrhythmia, ventricular tachycardia, and high-grade AV block. By the physical examination, the general examination may give you clues about the etiology. If you found enlarged lymph nodes with hilar lymphadenopathy, reticulonodulation on the chest radiograph, or by the CT chest, you should think of systemic sarcoidosis. If you show pleuritic maculopapular rash over the trunk and the arms and the leg, together with elevated eosinophil count with recent exposure to drug or toxin, think of hypersensitivity reaction. Patient with rapidly progressively heart failure, arrhythmia, either ventricular tachycardia or heart block, Think of one of both giant cell myocarditis or cardiac sarcoidosis. Laboratory evaluation for patients with myocarditis. TBC, totally non-specific. However, you can see leukocytosis. If you look at the eosinophil count, if it is high, you are lucky to diagnose allergic myocarditis. The ESR and CRP give you an overlook about the inflammation, the degree of inflammation. CRP have a prognostic role. No longer needed, rarely indicated to do serial viral antibody test. It rises fourfold and decline and gain, usually in the early stage of constitutional symptoms of fever, joint pain, and then without the symptoms of without cardiovascular evident cardiovascular symptoms, rarely indicated. Anticardiac antibody test, low specificity and no longer needed. Rheumatologic screening is essential with antinuclear antibody and rheumatoid factor. Markers of myocardial injury like CKMB, cardiac troponin, high sensitive troponin is essential for both the diagnosis and the prognosis of the disease. Electrocardiogram help you to detect the arrhythmia to show specific manifestation. As we said before, right bundle branch plot is a peculiar for Chagas disease. The echocardiogram, there is no single specific echocardiographic feature to distinguish myocarditis. However, the assessment of left ventricular function is essential both for the diagnosis, it supports the presence of myocardial damage, and also for the prognosis. Assessment of right ventricular function is also important to have a prognostic role. Assessment of pulmonary artery pressure is very important. In patients with fulminant myocarditis, the damage is very rapid. There is no space of time to lead to ventricular dilatation. Usually, the typical picture, non-dilated ventricle with depressed ejection fraction, thickened the myocardial wall with increased texture, edematous wall. Regional wall motion abnormality may be typical for coronary artery disease. Pericardial effusion usually signify myopericarditis. The role of cardiovascular MR is very essential as it can target all the pathological process in the myocarditis. It can detect myocardial edema, can detect myocardial injury, hyperemia, and later on necrosis or scarring, and supportive feature for diagnosis. The myocardial edema typically detected with T2 imaging or the improved new technique T2 mapping that decrease the noise and lead to accurate quantification of the magnitude of edema. T1 imaging and gadolinium enhancement either early or late detect the hyperemia and the myocardial necrosis or scar. And other supporting feature like the global left ventricular function, regional wall function, presence of pericardial effusion. Originally, there is a Lake-Lewis criteria. Any 2 out of 3 from the slide can diagnose myocarditis. And the updated features in 2018, any 2 out of 2. As here in the updated features in 2018, detection of T2 map is more important than the T2 image. In decreasing the noise, improve quantification of the amount of the edema. Also, the abnormal T1 quantification of extracellular volume by or late gadolinium enhancement. Supporting feature, as we said, presence of pericarditis, pericardial effusion, or systolic or regional wall dysfunction. In sarcoidosis, that can be detected by the PET scan, which is very specific for the diagnosis. We can see a mismatch between myocardial perfusion and the metabolic activity. Endomyocardial biopsy is the gold standard for diagnosis of myocarditis. However, it can be done routinely. For the indication, it should be used reserved only when a specific histologic disorder is suspected, like giant cell myocarditis or sarcoidosis, especially if it has an impact on the treatment. In giant cell myocarditis, sarcoidosis, steroid may be used or immunosuppressive agent. Why the broad use of endomyocardial biopsy has been limited? Because of its high cost, because of the limited availability of the experienced center, because of the large inter-observer variability, lack of evidence-based effective treatment for myocarditis, Dallas criteria have no prognostic value. The sensitivity is low, which is beyond the sampling technique. The development of immune histochemistry to detect the cell antigen improved the result. Viral genome analysis also improved the result. By all of these new techniques, the sensitivity may reach up to 40%. Identification of viral activity by endomyocardial biopsy adds to the diagnosis of myocarditis, like the copy number of the virus or replicative intermediate. The endomyocardial bulbs is indicated in rapidly progressive heart failure despite conventional therapy or suspected specific causes of myocarditis like giant cell myocarditis, xenophilic myocarditis, or sarcoidosis. The diagnosis of myocarditis can fall in three categories: either definite myocarditis, which is done by the endomyocardial biopsy, or a probable acute myocarditis that combines the presence of symptoms suggestive of myocarditis, together with evidence of myocardial damage, either by elevation of biomarker or by myocardial imaging like the echocardiogram or cardiovascular MRI. In patients with possible subclinical acute myocarditis, there is no symptom. However, you can find evidence of myocardial damage either by elevation of biomarker or positive imaging modality. Specific clinical presentation of myocarditis. Acute myocarditis presented by constitutional symptoms of fever, chills, myalgia, and most commonly dyspnea, arrhythmia, palpitation, or chest pain. In a chronic active myocarditis, which encompasses 60 to 70% of patients with active or borderline myocarditis who present with dilated cardiomyopathy. This patient, usually older patient, as we said, due to tolerance of the immune system, the symptoms is moderate and the cardiac affection is moderate. They slowly progress to diastolic dysfunction due to predominance of fibrosis. Fulminant myocarditis represents only 10% of patients with biopsy-proven myocarditis. It usually has an abrupt onset, leading to hemodynamic compromise and hypotension, usually necessitating the use of mechanical circulatory assist device. There is diffuse global affection by the cardiac imaging and also by the endomyocardial biopsy. Support of these patients is very important because they have a very good prognosis. If you support them, most of them will recover. Giant cell myocarditis, it has a subtle onset, usually present by rapidly progressive heart failure and arrhythmia, like ventricular tachycardia or high AV block. For this patient, the survival is very, very poor, with the survival of this population is less than 6 months. How to treat this patient? Early use of high-dose multi-agent immune suppression may improve the prognosis. And put this patient on the mechanical circulatory assist device. If it fails, go for cardiac transplantation. Cardiac transplantation may be the only alternative in this patient population. Eosinophilic myocarditis may represent one of three, either allergic eosinophilic myocarditis due to hypersensitivity reaction to foreign antigens, or systemic eosinophilic disorder, Loeffler endocarditis, or lastly, fulminant necrotic myocarditis that present similar to fulminant myocarditis. Peripartum cardiomyopathy, development of ventricular dysfunction in the last month of pregnancy or within 5 months of delivery. There is no pre-existing cardiac dysfunction, no recognized cause of dilated cardiomyopathy. There is evidence that the patient submitted to endomyocardial biopsy and no evidence of myocarditis. Treatment. Immunosuppressive drug routine use is not necessary. In the U.S. myocarditis treatment trial, which randomized the patient to either prednisone plus azathioprine or cyclosporine versus placebo only, there is no effect on the ejection fraction or transplant-free survival. This is a negative trial. However, a significant exception for the use of immunosuppressive drug is giant cell myocarditis, sarcoidosis, or eosinophilic myocarditis. And another trial, tailored immune suppression in inflammatory cardiomyopathy trial, small number of patients without persistent viral infection, randomized to receive either prednisone, azathioprine, or placebo. In this trial, there is marked improvement in the ejection fraction and improved quality of life. This means ongoing trials regarding the use of immune suppressive drug is needed. In case of chronic patients with heart failure dilated cardiomyopathy, is this patient positive or if they are patient viral negative, short course of immune suppression may help. The treatment of viral infection have a very limited role in the management of myocarditis. It may help in the management of post-transplantation viral heart disease in children. In a very small trial that suggested the interferon 3 times per week can improve the adenoviral heart infection. Ventricular arrhythmia or heart block due to acute myocarditis. Hospitalize the patient for electrocardiographic monitoring. Usually the arrhythmia resolves with the improvement of the condition. When the inflammation is present, the patient recover. However, during the acute setting and in the emergencies, these patients should be managed as usual. The indication of ICD is the same. However, the threshold should be low, especially in patients with giant cell myocarditis or cardiac sarcoidosis, due to the presence of extensive fibrosis in these two subsets of patients. Patients with suspected lymphocytic myocarditis and non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, a vest may be used whether to determine whether the arrhythmia persists after acute inflammatory response, which may be prolonged for several weeks or not. Then a mechanical circulatory support use a bridge to either transplantation or recovery in patients with cardiogenic shock. Time to recover is variable, ranging from few weeks to few months. Transplantation is an effective therapy in patients refractory to heart failure despite optimal medical treatment and even the circulatory assist device with similar survival rate due to cardiac transplantation due to another reason. This slide summarizes the management strategy for patients with myocarditis. Patients with myocarditis, if the hemodynamic unstable, is stabilized with diuretics or vasodilators. If the patient is still unstable, go to the inotropic agent. If not responding, go to the mechanical circulatory assist device. During this period, you may use immune suppressive agent, especially in patients with giant myocarditis or cardiac sarcoidosis, or patient with allergic myocarditis due to autoimmune disease. If the patient can't be stabilized despite all of this, you may consider cardiac transplantation. If the patient is hemodynamically stable, conventional treatment for heart failure, ACE or ARBs, beta blocker, plus or minus mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, and follow up the patient by clinical evaluation and echocardiogram. What about prescription of exercise? Should be avoided for up to 6 months because of the trials that it may increase the risk of this. Length of restriction may be guided by recovery of left ventricular function by echo. How to follow up this patient? By consensus, initially 1 to 3 months interval by clinical evaluation and serial echocardiogram, the frequency is not known, tailored according to the clinical presentation. The prognosis of myocarditis. In the acute setting, the left ventricular function, the right ventricular function, the pulmonary artery pressure, and the presence of active myocarditis on endomyocardial biopsy predict the risk of death and the need of transplantation in this patient. In patients with chronic dilated cardiomyopathy, the presence of inflammatory cells may suggest a short trial of immune suppression in this patient may improve heart failure. In patients bridged to recovery with left ventricular assist device, myocardial inflammation was present, but the fibrosis was less evident. And this patient's fulminant myocarditis, as we said before, they have good prognosis. The cause of cardiovascular collapse mainly due to extensive inflammation, but the scar is minimal or is small. So if you support these patients by circulatory assist device and the inotropic agents, you may end with a good result. The cardiovascular imaging has very important prognostic issue, especially on the development of heart failure or arrhythmia. Fortunately, most of the patients will have full spontaneous recovery. In myocarditis treatment trial, the patients who have heart failure due to myocarditis, the one-year mortality is 20, and four-year mortality reach up to 50% like any heart failure. In a hospital case series, fulminant myocarditis has much better prognosis than patients without fulminant myocarditis. Regarding the progression to dilated cardiomyopathy, up to one-half develop cardiomyopathy over a range of 3 up to 13 years. Histologic evidence of myocarditis in endomyocardial biopsy done for idiopathic cardiomyopathy, 10%. The risk of developing heart block requiring pacemaker is quite low, about 1%. Thank you.